Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this third and final episode in our series of virtual seminar events we're running during January and February, all about defined benefit, DB, pensions and advice. Thank you again for registering for this. We hope that you and those close to you are staying well. Thanks also to everyone who's been with us on one or both of our first two sessions over the past couple of weeks. We are excited to be doing these events, having run a similar series back in May 2020. Of course, the DB pensions advice market continues to be subject to a lot of scrutiny, a lot of change. So we thought it'd be good to reconvene and run this fresh series for 2022. I'm Peter Lovegrove. My colleague Rebecca Prestige and I both work in Grant Thornton's regulatory advisory practice. Hello again, Rebecca. How are you?
Morning, Peter. Very well, thank you. You?
Yeah, I'm all right, thank you. Rebecca and I are both pension transfer specialists. And our team has done a lot of work over the past 2 to 3 years now with firms and other industry parties on various aspects of defined benefit pension advice. So we're looking to share some observations and insights with you. A couple of the usual logistical housekeeping points. This is a virtual event. We're recording it and it will be distributed to all those who registered for the event as soon as we can afterwards. And you'll forgive us and bear with us if there are any unexpected interruptions. We continue to work remotely to a large part, so if there are things out of our control, please do forgive us. So let's just briefly signpost what we've been covering across these three events. So starting a couple of weeks ago on the 26th of January, we had a look at the current state of this market, the outlook for this year, in the context of issues surrounding advice given to members of the British Steel Pension Scheme, and indeed the impact of the more recent changes to the FCA's rules and guidance. Then last week, the 2nd of February, we gave some detailed insights on how we think the FCA's Defined Benefit Advice Assessment Tool, or DBAT, should be used when either giving or reviewing past advice. And today we're going to look at what we think that the key components are of a compliant, high quality DB pension advice solution in the light of FCA scrutiny, and particularly on British Steel cases and those rule changes that took place in 2018 and 2020. So we'll talk a bit about, you know, in what scenarios is a transfer more likely or less likely and why. Our format is straightforward. So Rebecca and I have a conversation to explore this. But as usual, we'd love you to participate. If you have got any questions you'd like to ask, then just please submit them via the chat function and we'll do our best to address them during or perhaps towards the end of the session. We certainly had some interesting queries over the first 2 weeks, so thank you for those. Today's topic is pretty meaty, especially as we examine sort of different scenarios of what good or poor may look like. We'll do our very best to stick to the time, but please do forgive us if we run over very slightly. So Rebecca, what's on our agenda today?
Yes, thank you, Peter. So today we'll build on last week's session on using the DBAT to explore how to develop solutions that meet a client's true needs, including use of the APTA. We'll consider some alternatives and we'll look at sort of cash flow modelling and investment advice. Yeah. So we're going to cover the component parts of the APTA, including the TBC, the principles underpinning advice, some typical scenarios driving DB advice that advisors encounter, and in each case, consider when a transfer is more or less likely to be appropriate and why, obviously bearing in mind alternative solutions. Hopefully we'll offer a few good tips on some suitability reports, whilst appreciating, of course, that this can be subjective.
Yeah.
And we'll talk about this as though advice were happening now, but as we mentioned in last week's DBAT session, it's important to know that this is all just as relevant when you're reviewing advice that was given in the past. And need to consider how well all of these areas were covered at that time and can be evidenced as such. This is particularly important given the FCA's ongoing scrutiny and expectation that firms review their past business, and the increasing possibility, as we discussed in the previous weeks, of a Section 404 redress scheme for advice given to British members to transfer out.
Indeed, okay.
So if we move on to APTA and TBC, let's start with how the FCA sets out what it requires of advisors when formulating advice solutions regarding a customer's DB assets. So we need to describe the APTA, the appropriate pension transfer analysis, and the TBC. We're going to do that.
Yeah.
What are key points of these requirements, Peter, do you think?
Okay, yes, it's a good place to start, isn't it? So I guess as many people looking at this will know, the APTA, the Appropriate Pension Transfer Analysis, and the TVC, the Transfer Value Comparator, which is part of it, became effective in October 2018, sort of replacing the old sort of TVAS regime that many people would have been familiar with. So what's going on here? Well, I mean, the SCA is sort of quite prescriptive and sort of not at the same time. So because no two customers are exactly the same, the SCA believes that it's advisors that are best placed to consider the detailed approach which is appropriate for each individual. Yep. Therefore, I think the APTA is there are some prescriptive bits to it, but it's more of a concept. It's an approach to advising customers on their safeguarded pension benefits. It's the TVC, the comparator, that's the only really specifically mandatory component.
Yes, yeah, that's right, I agree. So the APTA, I think, you know, as we said, it's a crucial guide, even perhaps a to-do list of issues that the advice should cover. So what would a good advisor consider?
Yeah, so you're right, it's a concept, but in practice it's going to cover lots of similar things. I think it's not really possible to provide a suitable compliant piece of DB advice unless you've identified and at least considered a number of important things. Those things including the customer's outgoings and therefore their potential income and capital needs and expectations throughout retirement. That's very, very important. We'll come and talk about cash flow modelling, but lots of advisors are using that now and assessing that and capacity for loss. The APTA will need to include considering the role the DB scheme can play alongside other assets in meeting these income and capital needs, how any spouse or partner and dependents are going to be catered for, the impact and risk if a DB transfer is made. The APTA advisors are going to need to consider how desirable it or necessary it is for the customer to access different assets at different times. If you're contemplating a transfer out, then a comparative analysis of the benefits to be provided by that potential destination scheme and the current DB scheme. More usual things like alignment with the customer's risk attitude to investment risk profile and their capacity for loss, comparing the different death benefits from the scheme they're currently in with a potential destination scheme. Are there alternative ways of meeting the customer's objectives, particularly their retirement income and capital needs? So other DC schemes, for example, what the tax implications of any advice might be, the status of their state benefits. You know, I think that's overlooked sometimes, isn't it? Access to state benefits.
Yeah.
Also, think about not only retirement needs now, but all the way through their retirement. I think, we think it's prudent to go a little bit further than average or expected life expectancy to make sure that the risk of funds running out is mitigated as much as possible. A couple of other things also in terms of the APTA, an objective, impartial consideration to the extent applicable of the Pension Protection Fund and also the FSDS.
Yep.
And finally, this key component, the transfer value comparator, the TVC. We are a bit mindful of the time today, so I'm not going to go into TVC in loads of detail, but it is important. What are the key things in the TVC, I think, Rebecca?
Well, good question. So it contains a number of complexities and actuarial assumptions, some of which can be challenged. But fundamentally, the TVC will compare the cash equivalent transfer value of the DB scheme benefits with how much it would cost to purchase on the annuity market the guaranteed income for life that the scheme is offering. So it's a real sort of monetary comparison. For our purposes, we can say that the TVC is a key tool in quantifying and personalizing transfer risk to the customer in front of you. So we talked about all the APTA stuff. That's all highly personalized stuff. And so now we're really getting sort of personalization of the numbers. Before their individual TVC is presented to an individual customer, transfer risk is a fairly abstract concept. So the TVC really makes it real to them by pointing out in sort of pounds and pence their DB benefits and what it would cost to replace them. You know, so fairly powerful, I think.
I think that's right. Yeah, and we've seen advice processes, which we think is good practice, whereby there's like a standalone conversation with the customer just about this, isn't there? So you know, in and around conversations around fact finding and presenting the suitability report, if there's a specific conversation about, look, this is your TVC, as you say, it's really powerful. It values the transfer risk in a way which is personal to the customer, and it helps the advisor really extract how the customer really feels about giving up the safeguarded benefits. Like you say, it moves it from an abstract concept into this is real, no, this is monetary terms, to quantify the transfer risk. And I say it's a good tool for advisors. Okay, so later this morning we're going to try and identify some of the drivers of the advice and then imagine what suitable might look like in those scenarios. But before we do, should we talk about some of the key principles underpinning the advice and advice solution? Okay, well let's perhaps start by recapping a foundational critical regulatory expectation, which is that advisors must start with an assumption that transferring DB assets is unsuitable. You've got to prove otherwise. So perhaps putting it in a more practical way, you should start as an advisor by trying to meet the customer's income and capital needs in retirement by keeping the DB assets where they are and using other assets to supplement what the DB scheme will provide. I think we feel that the FCA's view that borderline isn't good enough. You know, a transfer must be clearly in a customer's best interests. So to get there, you need to consider the customer's personal circumstances, you know, all the hard and soft facts about their needs, circumstances and aspirations, who their dependents are, health and lifestyle factors. I think also we like advisors to distinguish quite clearly between the customer's own perception of their needs and you as an advisor, your more objective, dispassionate identification of what their true realistic needs are. Those things can be different. Similarly, distinguishing between the customer's perception of what they think they might need and like versus your own objective, dispassionate assessment of the best means of using all of the customer's assets, including their DB scheme, to meet those true needs in retirement. That will, of course, include assessing the attitude to transfer risk specifically and attitude to investment risk as well.
Yeah, no, I think that's key. And I think sometimes, you know, looking at needs, you know, we need to compare needs and wants of a customer, and sometimes some challenging conversations need to be had there. I think also advisors need to consider security of income in retirement and the role the DB scheme will play in meeting those needs. And I think here we sort of really sort of look at the importance of a core secure income, so meeting sort of core income needs, and then the role of the scheme alongside other assets that the client might have. Legacy and estate planning comes into play, so establishing the actual need is important. It shouldn't ever really override meeting income needs. We think that this is often more of a sort of a, more likely to be a nice to have element. But we'd expect to see some sort of quantification of, you know, why sort of, you know, a legacy is needed or death benefits, how much, what other assets might be passed on that could meet that need. Obviously, the DB scheme and any alternatives should be considered on a like-for-like basis. That's quite important. And we've got, you know, whole of life as a possible solution, which we don't see too often, but it should always be. And then we've got sort of priorities and trade-offs. So if not all needs can be fully met, a sub-optimal solution can be suitable if the customer's objectives have been discerned using accurate information. So we're really dealing with accurate facts, and there is no demonstrably better alternative. Then, you know, the disadvantage trade-offs to a suboptimal solution can be clearly spelled out and agreed by the customer. So it's really having a detailed knowledge of the customer and how they feel about the potential sort of trade-offs.
That's right. It's quite often the case, isn't it, that not all of a customer's needs can be met in full. So managing customer expectations is that's important. Okay. Let's also explore a bit about cash flow modelling and capacity for loss, which sort of sit quite nicely together. So what do you think are the benefits of cash flow modelling for this type of advice?
So firstly, I think, and consistent with the idea that the APTA is more conceptual than prescriptive, there is no requirement to do cash flow modelling. However, we see I think we're seeing an ever increasing expectation that some form of cash flow modelling will take place, to the point where the FCA may well question why you don't do it, or certainly be sort of exploring what you are doing instead of cash flow modelling. So cash flow modelling really is the projection using a range of assumptions of the income that could be generated from a customer's assets over the course of their retirement. So like you say, it's a snapshot over the whole of retirement, not just at the beginning. And for the customer, I think it draws a picture of their household sort of respective positions in retirement, whether either remaining or transferring their DB scheme. And it helps to show the needs and goals that can or cannot be met in either event. So as we sort of discussed, you know, looking at sort of trade-offs here. I think for the advisor, it brings all the facts and figures into one sort of picture and attempts to sort of show how this develops over time. So it can be quite a good visual tool. And I think in turn, that should sort of help identify potential shortfalls and look at the options for trade-offs with the customer. There are many ways of working the cash flow modelling. We haven't got time today to go into any great detail. But I think an approach we think that works quite well is for the model to assume that savings and investments are used up first, which often the customer might be uncomfortable with. But we feel it sort of helps to demonstrate a more purist view on whether the customer's income needs can be best met by either remaining or transferring out. So it can be quite stark. Sometimes it can sort of get the customer to really sort of think about what their objectives are. And of course, the other big benefit with cash flow modelling is it's linked to capacity for loss. So you can build into cash flow modelling various assumptions commensurate with the customer's risk appetite. And sort of regarding reductions in the value or assets or income, and then stress test those and see whether or not the customer's needs can still be met, you know, in tough times. So I think cash flow modelling doesn't really stand out without sort of adequate stress testing. It's important.
I think that's right. And you're right. It's a bit like the TVC, isn't it? And it helps bring this to life for the customer. It turns concepts into actual pounds and pence for them. You know. How long is this money going to last? And what's the best sort of using things up? Okay. So we've discussed a little bit about the APTA as a concept and the key parts of it. The TVC, what that's for, some of the principles and drivers for advice. Let's try and bring this to life a bit more now. So let's talk through a series of scenarios, which we'll consider individually, but of course in the real world, many of them will sit alongside one another when you're giving or reviewing advice. In each case, setting out the issues, the nature of the situation, trying to think about when a transfer in principle is more and less likely, and some of the alternatives that might be considered. And I think whilst we're doing this, let's remember again that this is about possibly doing advice now, or indeed is thinking back to when the advice has been given, if you're reviewing advice now that was given in the past. What should the advisor have been thinking about at that time? Let's start with quite a stark one. Let's start with serious ill health. Customers in serious ill health. So talk us through that. What are the likely main features?
So I guess here we're looking at, you know, a customer with reduced life expectancy. So that's really what we're looking at with serious ill health, something that will impact longevity. And we consider this is probably the most likely good reason to override other factors that indicate a transfer might be unsuitable.
What are the likely trade-offs and alternatives, and is a transfer more or less likely, do you think?
A customer might get fuller value from the scheme if they stay in the scheme and live longer than expected, which is why we'd really sort of expect to have evidence on file around the actual customer's health, the customer's actual health position, and what the impact on life expectancy might be. We've obviously got to consider potential IHT on the transfer value on death within 2 years.
That's important.
So that's a factor. Transfer is, I guess, more likely to be suitable if they're looking to sort of maximise the pot before the customer becomes either too ill to use the funds, or the customer dies, before they can really maximise income from the scheme.
Key reason,
particularly if life expectancy is significantly reduced and or a partner doesn't qualify for spouse's pension. So they're all key factors. One of the alternatives that can be considered is obviously pension income exchange. So it's worth exploring that certainly worth exploring.
Yeah, we don't see that explored too often, do we? We don't see that explored too often.
No, we don't see that explored too often. And often, you know, we see overlooked is actual early retirement from the scheme and ill health retirement from the scheme. So these should all be explored. But, you know, potentially as well, if the customer's got significant other assets and then there's no need or wish to access or pass on DB assets at all. So, you know, whilst it might be unlikely, that's, you know, another potential reason that a transfer might stack up. So
Great.
Covers off the ill health side of things. Another scenario we see, Peter, quite a lot is where customers come in with sort of high CTV.
Yeah.
What are the main features, do you think, in these sort of scenarios?
Yeah, so this is an interesting one because the customer, sometimes the advisor as well, actually, can be sort of rather dazzled by an apparently high cash equivalent transfer value available from the scheme, possibly due to market conditions or possibly due to the scheme wanting to do something. And that's, you know, that's obviously significant, but we have to be wary because the customer and again, perhaps the advisor can be rather distracted or even highly incentivized by the CTV and that they're agitated about taking advantage of something now.
Yeah, absolutely. So what are the sort of likely trade-offs and alternatives to be considered here and when might a transfer be more or less likely?
Yeah, so I think in these situations, you know, it's important to remain as dispassionate as possible. So the goal has to remain, what are the customer's retirement income and capital needs and how can they best be met? That remains the overriding question and anything else is secondary in terms of how best to use the assets. The firm should consider to continue to consider all other sources of secure and other income available to meet those retirement needs. We think that obviously a high CTV and any limited period of time might be available is a factor, of course it is, but transferring purely on that basis, we think it's less likely to be suitable if that's the only driving factor. You know, whilst the cash equivalent transfer value might seem high, the transferred fund, wherever it goes, is then subject to the same market conditions that helped to create it.
Absolutely.
It may be that DC investment returns might be comparatively low. And of course, as soon as you transfer out, then the protections afforded to you by safeguarded benefits within a scheme, they fall away.
Yeah.
There may be some other alternatives that advisors can consider. So, the customer might be reliant on the DB scheme. We'll come on to that later. We know how important that is. If a customer is heavily reliant on that income to secure their basic income. Equally though, you know, a high transfer value, if possible, that higher transfer value could purchase a higher annuity income, a higher secure income, particularly perhaps if the customer only needs a single life annuity or an impaired annuity or an enhanced annuity. And of course, if the customer's got a high attitude to investment risk and has capacity for loss, then it may be that the customer wants to effectively invest in a different way or a different market where the scheme investments are made because they think they can beat the market and they can afford to take those sorts of.
And it's interesting on the annuity side, we don't often see as much annuity recommendations as perhaps we would expect.
No, but of course, advisors probably should think about it, please consider it and discount it.
They should.
All right, so from high dazzling transfer values, let's talk about where a customer says they want or says they need higher income. So talk through this scenario.
So we do see this often when people start looking at their retirement plans. And this is where, you know, we might have customers coming in focused on securing as much income as possible. So I think here it's sort of, we need to really consider cash flow modelling outputs. You know, and is it the scheme or an alternative the best means of meeting the customer's true income needs?
Okay, so what are the trade-offs and when might transfer be more or less likely?
So I guess here essentially the trade-off is often maximizing income means less for other priorities, perhaps spouse or partner income, and I think this is where discussions with the customer need to be had to really sort of work out and facilitate what their red lines are. we need to have conversations around whether compromises can be made, whether or not a client might need to amend their retirement spending. You know,
yeah,
often, you know, we all want a lot more income, but sometimes, you know, the pot isn't a magic pot, it can only go so far. Sometimes we need to sort of consider, you know, whether or not retiring a bit later is perhaps an option in order to sort of, you know, get a higher income. So I don't think this driver alone would suggest that a transfer is more likely to be suitable. And I think in practice, a more cautious approach to withdrawal levels from a drawdown arrangement would be necessary to really ensure sustainability of income throughout retirement. And I think it's important to really manage customers' expectations in this respect. I think similar to the high CETV, it's very hard to sort of get over the now bias with this is what I want now without really sort of thinking what the impact will be, you know, further into retirement. There's sort of possible exceptions to this alternative. So, you know, a customer, you know, as we mentioned before, might have a very high attitude to risk and effectively wants to invest in a different market environment to one that determines the transfer value. So we need to sort of factor those in, but we really need to be comfortable on the client's sort of attitude to transfer risk. I think that's key here. And really look at cash flow modelling stress testing to show that there is sufficient capacity for loss. And I guess as with all the other scenarios, you know, it could sometimes be that transferring out and buying an annuity could generate a higher secured income. So you can still get a secured income, I guess, by transferring out. But, you know, it's really sort of considering the trade-offs to having a higher income. So I guess brings us on to the other sort of real scenario that we see quite a lot. So we've got high income needs, but what about flexible income needs? I think this comes up quite a lot. Yes. So what's the situation here then?
It does. It's often cited as a key reason for transfer that the customer needs flexibility.
Yeah.
I think that we feel that, or we know the SA feels that flexibility is fine, but the need for flexibility or either an income or ad hoc lump sums needs to be detailed and personalised and quantified. You know, what does flexibility actually mean for that customer? And is there a genuine need for it? You know, let's be dispassionate. Is there a genuine need for that flexibility? There might be limited ways of taking DB benefits in comparison to other things.
Yeah, absolutely. So what trade-offs and alternatives do we need to consider here?
Yes, I mean, you mentioned it before, maximising income or creating flexibility might mean less for other priorities. As you say, it's not a magic pot. It only goes so far. Some of these foundational questions, is the customer willing and able to take transfer risk? Are they willing to move out of a safeguarded benefits environment? Do they have the appropriate attitude to investment risk as well? I think we feel that perhaps alongside serious ill health as a consideration and death benefits on some occasions, in principle, it is one where a transfer can add clear value and could be suitable because, you know, the income from a DB scheme is not flexible. The spouse's pension benefits are not flexible in the way that you can get somewhere else. But then on the flip side, you know, if the DB scheme benefits are taken and largely or even can completely cover what a customer needs, then flexibility is a bit illusory. The client already has that from an income that the DB scheme can provide. The customer might like the idea of flexibility in principle, but yeah, they might not have as much as they think they do, and they need to be cautious with their withdrawal. The more you take earlier on in your retirement, the less you have for later on, and it's supposed to last your whole retirement. Alternatives or other means of creating flexibility could include taking the DB scheme either early or at normal retirement age, but using the PCLFs, the tax-free cash, to create, you know, more income or more capital earlier on in retirement. Or indeed, the customer may have other assets, non-pension related, or indeed they might be able to borrow money. Yeah, that might be something to consider for some customers.
Yeah.
All right. So it's flexibility important to personalise it. Let's move on to customers who are younger. Think about a transfer when they're younger, or perhaps they want to retire earlier than the DB scheme normal retirement age. Just talk us through that one.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I mean, so you know, a young customer is one thing, and then wanting to retire early, I guess, is a separate sort of point. So here, this is where we often see people coming in, you know, who are focused on retiring as soon as possible. And, you know, even though early retirement factors can be prohibitive, they should be actuarially neutral and based on average life expectancy of the scheme. So we would always expect to see an advisor exploring the options available from the scheme, you know, first and foremost. And then younger customers, obviously, you know, we're looking at the why now question more so.
Okay, so what's the usual question? What are the trade-offs? What you know, the transfer of life is more or less likely in principle?
Yeah, so when looking to sort of retire early, having really sort of assessed the income needs, the first question we need to ask is the customer being realistic about retiring early? Can, if they want to retire early, are there any other assets or holdings that could bridge shortfalls until scheme retirement? So it's sort of looking at preserving the scheme at all costs sort of concept. Early retirement can result in potentially lower transfer values than if the customer waits until nearer the scheme retirement age, although obviously there's no guarantees on what the CETV will be in the future. But transferring out, especially if somebody's young, you know, death benefits, you know, will be lost on transfer, so that's always worth considering. And as I mentioned, for younger customers, I think transfer is a lot less likely to be suitable, and it always raises the why now question, which, you know, can be quite difficult to justify and overcome. And for obvious reasons, really, you know, the younger the client is, the more difficult it is for them, and therefore you as an advisor, to get a clear understanding of what the retirement income and capital needs might be. Things change, you know, we don't know what someone's, you know, situation might be in 10, 20 years time, or whatever it is. I guess as with the other examples, as with sort of higher income and CETV scenarios, there may be some circumstances where transferring out and buying an annuity would generate a higher income. But I guess we would always look to sort of address this at the time that the customer can take benefits. You know, I'm not sure transferring out now with the option of buying an annuity, you know, in many years' time, you know, would be a prudent decision. So lots of things to consider there.
Yes, that's that why now question is key here, isn't it? You know, why are we doing this now? Why not wait a few years?
Yeah, well, exactly.
There may be good reasons, but it's hard to do sometimes.
Yeah, exactly. And that brings us on to sort of another example of customers who want to sort of maximise sort of tax-free cash. You know, it's the sort of, you know, I want to sort of get at money now, really, and as much as I can often. What are the sort of main features when customers are looking to maximise PCLS?
Yeah, so as you say, you know, it's straightforward. The customer is understandably attracted by the idea of obtaining as much tax-free cash, PCLS, as possible. I think we have to think about this and research it properly as an advisor. You know, we have to be careful. So it isn't always the case, but DB scheme commutation factors tend to be less generous. You know, we often see that it's likely that the PCLS would be higher from a DC scheme, so that does act as a sort of a consideration or a motivational factor for customers that are looking to transfer.
Yeah, and so what do they need to sort of consider and trade off in these sort of examples?
Yeah, so there are some similar things that we've talked about in other areas. So, you know, could other assets or holdings create this capacity? Either to create cash or to bridge any capital shortfalls. We have to bear in mind, I think, as an advisor, that if you defer taking the PCLS, it could lead to it being higher in the future. Yeah. If the customer's aim is to maximise it, then, yeah, again, why now? Why not wait a bit? We've talked a bit about cash flow modelling. So, yeah, consider those cash flow modelling outputs. So, you know, the PCLS notwithstanding, is the scheme, or an alternative, the best means of meeting the customer's true retirement income needs? That's always the key question. We've got to think about the whole retirement here, not just the shorter term needs.
Exactly.
I think we feel, just in principle, all things being equal, a transfer is less likely to be suitable if maximizing tax-free cash is the sole or primary driver. You know, you need to establish as an advisor in detail the key reasons why you know, high tax-free cash is desirable. There are some possible exceptions or alternatives. So The customer might need that tax-free cash for a very important reason. Yep. There's no realistic alternative, debt repayment, mortgage repayment, funding children's house purchases or education, those sorts of things. There's no realistic alternative to that cash for using it for that reason. Mm. And indeed, as we talked about in other scenarios, there might be some circumstances where transferring and buying an annuity would generate higher income.
Mm.
All right, yep. Let's move on to situations where, and we see this quite a lot, we've touched on it before, where the DB scheme is the main or even the sole means of retirement provision for a customer. So let's talk us through the key features of that one.
Yeah, so we do see this quite a lot in our review work. And I think actually one of the questions has come through around, scenarios where a client might have their DB scheme as their own sort of real source of guaranteed income. So here, as we said, the customer's got little or no other pension provision. So this is their main scheme. And ensuring that there's enough income for sort of fixed and discretionary spending is key when looking at sort of, one DB scheme. Yeah. And I guess,
the likely... what are our trade-offs and alternatives?
Yeah. So I think we really need to consider cash flow modelling outputs here. PCLS notwithstanding, is the scheme or an alternative the best ways of meeting the customer's true income needs? So, we wouldn't rule out a transfer if a customer only had one DB scheme, but obviously we really need to look at it carefully. Whilst we think that a transfer is less likely to be suitable with a DB scheme is the sole or main pension provision, there are still scenarios where, a transfer might be more suitable. If the DB scheme pension and a transferred pension both meet the customer's needs, i.e. it's a fairly sort of neutral equation, then that wouldn't be sufficient enough to sort of pass the starting test that a transfer is not likely to be suitable. So there would need to be a particular reason why a transfer would better meet the needs. So that could be in examples where there's like genuine flexibility needs that we've sort of discussed. Or where a customer has got no need for a spouse's pension or other dependents' benefits. Or another sort of main reason that we see where a DB scheme, can be transferred and meet the needs is where, for example, it's a large CETV transfer and there is a relatively small draw needed from that pot. So, where we've got a big fund and, a very sort of modest income need from that, then that still might be suitable to transfer and it can meet other needs, perhaps inheritability. But the client would really need to have the sort of right attitude to transfer risk and investment risk to support transfer. But I hope that sort of answered the question that has come through on that. Talking of sort of, other needs and inheritability, another reason we see for to support transfer sometimes is sort of legacy, estate planning, death benefits. These can be sometimes sort of, key drivers. But obviously, as we know, and we sort of talked about the DB scheme, really the main sort of, reason for the DB scheme is to provide a client's income needs in retirement. So they tend to be the most important. But what do we need to consider when we've sort of got death benefits and, legacy planning on the agenda?
Yeah, so you're right. We see this quite a lot, don't we? That customers like the idea of passing on some of their pension assets to their spouse, partner, dependents, or other people. And of course, that's why wouldn't you want to do that? But you're right. We have to remember that this pension, its primary purpose is to sustain a good standard of living for the pensioner. That has to be its primary purpose. But of course, you've got to respect and understand what people want. So the key, I think, is to establish how important this is. I think often we see advisors say in defending their advice, if the customer said they wanted to pass this on, they wanted inheritability. But what the advisor didn't establish was just how important that was. Where did it rank in the priorities? Is it essential or is it a nice have for people? I think you mentioned that earlier. Of course, death benefits might be good immediately after transfer, but in later years, as death becomes more likely, the fund might be much smaller.
Indeed it might. So what are the trade-offs and alternatives to consider when sort of looking at death benefits as a driver?
I mean, as we said elsewhere, catering for this desire, providing a legacy, reduces the amount available to the customer or perhaps their spouse or partner as well, during their own lifetimes. So just how important is it the customer leaves something behind? Can the customer compromise whether those needs are more important? Particularly about when the other assets might be passed on. A transfer price might be more suitable if this is linked to a customer with reduced life expectancy or in serious ill health. But for customers with normal life expectancy, again, transferring mainly or purely to create a legacy is that the sole or key driving factor is less likely to be suitable, I think. Now, there may be alternatives. So for all the customers, annuitizing might be more suitable. And again, I think you mentioned earlier, we don't see this very often, but advisors can also consider a whole of life plan or some other means of meeting death benefits if leaving money behind to other people is really important.
Okay.
let's move on. Conscious of time, let's move on to situations where, again, we see this quite often, customers have more than one DB scheme. What are the main features here?
Yeah, well, so we do see this quite often, certainly in our review work, where somebody's got either two schemes or two periods of service, and the schemes are sort of treated independently of each other, possibly DC schemes also to add into the mix. And I think here the key thing to really consider is ensuring that there is enough income for fixed and discretionary spending. And in doing so, the advisor should really consider the role to be played by the DB schemes and whether or not either one or both could or should be transferred.
That's right. And if so, which one? Yeah. So what are the trade-offs and things to consider? And is a transfer more likely, do you think?
Yeah, well, so the first question, I think, is do some or all of the DB schemes provide enough income to meet the customer's retirement income needs? So that's the first thing to discover. Check sort of life cover options if leaving a legacy is an objective. So you wouldn't want to necessarily leave a scheme and sort of give up death benefits if you don't need to. Consider whether or not any other assets can be used, and you know, if income flexibility is required. And I think really it's about considering whether a transfer is suitable for each of the schemes individually, but by considering them alongside each other. So sometimes it could be, you know, the fact that you're keeping one scheme is a reason then to transfer another, you know, but then you can't sort of use the same sort of argument, you know, on both sides and then end up transferring both. If the customer has income security from some or all of the schemes and or other sources, then the downside of transferring what we would consider an excess scheme is reduced and therefore more likely to be suitable. If the customer needs flexibility or wants to leave additional funds to the family, then transferring a scheme that is providing excess income is also more likely to be suitable. And I think if the customer needs all DB schemes to meet income needs, then a transfer is unlikely to be suitable. Again, there are sort of other exceptions or alternatives. So genuine flexibility needs, you know, whether or not we need to bridge to state pension, or for example, if the customer's got no spouse, you know, to benefit from spouse's pension or dependents' benefits.
Agreed. Complicated.
It can be complicated, and often we see firms falling down on, you know, sort of not getting that bit right. And in fact, you end up really depleting a customer's options by perhaps transferring all without really considering, you know, keeping some. A couple more. We're getting there now. What about managing debt management? This is another sort of sometimes reason we see people coming in, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. So you're right. This scenario can be quite straightforward, either on its own or alongside other things. But yeah, the customer's got significant debt to repay and is perhaps almost forced to consider, and the advisor is forced to consider using DB pension assets to repay that debt.
Yeah. I mean, difficult. And I think this, I guess, is where, you know, the trade-off conversations are, you know, massively important, and considering alternatives.
That's right. I mean, I think, you know, pretty much everyone would accept that using DB assets in this way to pay debt is a last resort, really. Obviously, using it to repay debt reduces the amount available to the customer and those that that are dependent on them throughout their lifetimes. And, you know, can the customer compromise on using DB assets to repay the debt if other needs are more important? I mean, I guess we feel that a transfer is unlikely to be suitable unless there really is absolutely no alternative. And and not transferring to repay the debt would create real significant financial hardship, even poverty throughout a customer's retirement. I think also it's worth, if you're an advisor, you've got to consider that if a customer has significant debt problems like this, that could indicate very low capacity for loss. It could indicate vulnerability. It could indicate, relatively poor financial literacy. That this person struggles to manage and plan their money. And that again, are all good reasons to think really, really long and hard before moving money out of an environment where that the benefits are safeguarded and income is secure. Now, if the customer is still accumulating, that they haven't yet retired, then there may be ways of exploring how to repay the debt in other ways. Different borrowing or using different assets to pay debt. But yeah, I think we would feel that trying using the DB scheme as a last resort.
Okay.
All right, let's move on to one other thing. Again, something we do see every now and again, particularly with British Steel cases, of course, where there are some sort of problem with the scheme. Lack of confidence in the scheme, or the scheme is underfunded. Of course, at face value, that might seem as though it lends itself to a transfer, but perhaps not necessarily. So, yeah, talk us through this one. What are the main features?
Yeah, and in fact, we've had a question through about this as well, about whether a high CETV could be indicative of underfunding in a DB scheme, and whether or not that fall is a possible plus point towards transferring. I think here, what we're really looking at is whether or not the scheme is underfunded, and whether or not the sponsoring employer has any funding in place. So there could well be a high CETV, but I think it really incumbent upon the advisor to understand and establish the status of the scheme, and then consider that in isolation of the high CETV. It's likely to concern the customer, I guess, and some advisors, and we've seen a lot of this, as you say, with British Steel, but really it's for the advisor to consider the situation objectively. If the employer fails and the scheme could go into PPF, deferred benefits up to the cap are largely secured at 90%, which may well be fine for some customers if they need or prefer security of a known steady income for life. I think often, it's about positioning of the PPF. We don't often see it positioned as the lifeboat that it is. Often we see it as sort of a doomsday scenario, demonstrated to the customer. So it's really about being objective. Sometimes taking a definitive view can be difficult, but I think the idea here will be to compare transfer with the benefits of PPF. So instead of looking at PPF as doomsday, it's what can I get from PPF, and whether or not that's the right thing for the client, notwithstanding the scheme underfunding.
Yeah. Okay. Is that the trade-offs and alternatives? What do you think? Is the transfer more or less likely?
So I guess if the customer's concerned about going into PPF and losing 10%, why transfer to a DC arrangement and risk losing more is the first question that you need to ask. Sometimes 90% of secured, income is a good thing. How would losing 10% of scheme income affect meeting retirement income needs? Is it really sort of down to the wire that extra 10% is sort of going to make or break somebody's retirement? I think even if the scheme is underfunded, this is unlikely on its own to be a good reason for transfer. So transfer has to stack up, regardless. And then if it is looking like it's going into PPF, then we need to consider transfer alongside PPF. Obviously, we've got some other sort of scenarios. So if, for example, the DB scheme pension is in excess of the PPF cap, then, that could perhaps lend itself more to considering transfer. Or if, there is a high proportion of pre-97 accrual, and if there is quite some time to go before retirement. So there are some things to consider there.
Great, thank you. I'm conscious of time. We've got some questions coming in. So that was a bit of a whistle stop to us through some of the main scenarios that advisors might encounter when either giving or reviewing advice. I guess one other thing to say we haven't touched on so far that could apply to any of those scenarios is the possibility of a partial transfer.
Yes.
Again, something we perhaps don't see advisors exploring enough. Retaining sufficient assets in a DB scheme to provide supports your income that meets the needs, but then transferring any excess to create flexibility or extra cash, or you know, or legacy, or other things we talked about. Also, if the customer has ill health, you know, retirement income could be boosted by a partial transfer and the purchase of a serious ill health or an enhanced annuity.
Yep.
Okay, we'll try and finish up now. Just a few thoughts on suitability reports. So we've explored, you know, how to craft a suitable recommendation. Let's just talk very briefly about some good practice in suitability reports. Yeah. What have you seen? What tips can we offer?
Yeah, so this, you know, is of course an area where beauty is in the eye of the beholder, and we see lots of variation here. There are various schools of thought on the most effective approach to suitability reports, especially in such a complex area of financial planning. The FCA has been accused of wanting it both ways, so telling advisors that they must provide all the detail that could be relevant to a client, whilst then warning advisors about drowning customers in unnecessary detail that obscures the key points. But I think we can probably offer some observations of good practice that we've seen, and things that, you know, FCA seems to prefer. So firstly, you know, you're the advisor, give some advice. I know this sounds strange, but we do see suitability reports often that don't give a clear, definite recommendation whether to transfer or to remain in the DB scheme. So make sure that the recommendation, whatever it is very clear. Another pet hate of ours is, you know, the equivocal or conditional recommendation. So something that effectively, you know, might be, if you feel like this, then you should consider this action, you know, but on the other hand, if you think that, then maybe this course of action would be better suited, which sort of really leaves it up to the client to have to sort of work out what's best for them. And we think the FCA regards this, I guess, as we do, as an abdication of the responsibility of the advisor. You know, the customer has a right to expect a clear recommendation and a course of action. The reasons for the recommendation must be clear and really directly related to the hard and soft facts that have been gathered throughout the whole process. So personalization is key here. You know, we see templated reports, that's fine. We see non-templated reports, that's fine. But where it really does sort of fall down is where there's not enough personalization.
Yeah, agreed. And also, it should also explain the alternatives that you've considered and discounted, I think, as well, shouldn't it? So, yeah, we're sometimes asked, you know, there's a multitude of different, huge number of different possible approaches here. Do I really need to identify and discount each one? It's a good question. We think that in practice, no, you know, you don't have to describe every possible scenario. It's more identifying and describing and discounting the more serious possibilities that were realistic alternatives, what's being considered in terms of meeting the customer's goals. It's worth mentioning, I think we touched on this in our first session, that the changes in 2020 mean that you now have got to rule out, or indeed recommend, but rule out a workplace scheme as an alternative destination if that's not what you're recommending.
That's right. And I think we should also note that from October 2020, firms now have to provide a mandatory one-page summary at the front of a suitability report, which I think is useful to highlight the recommendation and key information that it would expect to be sort of detailed within the suitability report. I mean, fundamentally, the one-page summary should clearly state whether the customer should transfer or convert their pension, and signpost where to find more detailed explanation for the recommendation in the main body of the report. We have seen examples of advisors doing this before it was a rule, you know, which sort of strikes us as good practice. And of course, one crucial aspect of the recommendation and suitability report is whether and how it's peer reviewed. So I think that's key as well.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Rebecca, very much for going through that with us. It's 5 to 11. I'm conscious we've got a little bit of time. We are seeing some questions come in. A couple of them, Rebecca, you've artfully answered as we've been going through, I think. Let's try and address a couple of these if we possibly can. So first question that came in, forgive me if I can ask you this. When running a TVC analysis, where the DB pension, as is typical, has three different elements, GMP, excess, etc., each of which revalue different rates, where some of the DB may not increase, some are LPI, some are 3%, what should you use for the TVC input? Is that something we can answer, or might we want to take that one away?
Yeah, we might want to take that away. I mean, it would need to sort of be reflective of, you know, what it costs to replace the scheme benefit. So yeah, we'll take that one away. I don't know if you need to do multiple ones or if you can sort of add in all of those different rates.
Yeah, that is a good and technically detailed question that warrants a bit of thought. So perhaps we'll take that one away. We'll try and provide a response when we issue the recording of this event. Thank you for the question. Did we answer the high CTV one?
I think we did. I think we've answered the high CTV one and sort of underfunding, and then where the scheme is the only source of income. I think we've answered that one. Question four, we can have a look through. I mean, just quickly on question five about the removal, well, whatever one it was, about removal of the PPF cap. I think that is being, that's in the process of being done. And I think that's sort of going to take until the end of the year, I think, to remove that cap. But yeah, that is in motion.
Yeah. The question about flexibility. The need to clarify why flexibility is needed and wanted is understood. But do you have user opinions, clients concerned about being tied in from relatively young age of, say, 60? For a lifetime, when there are many life changes may not happen over the 20 years. Good question. And once they take scheme benefits, they've got nowhere else to go. I mean, we sort of covered that. This is about, I think, being clear about what flexibility means for that individual and what they want it to mean for them. So to what extent do they really need the capacity to be flexible with when and how they take the income? If it's strongly desirable, and all other, you know, other factors line up, then yeah, transfer may well be an appropriate thing for that customer. It's a good point though, you know, people are living longer, which is a good thing. And if you're retiring at 60, 62, 65, you know, fingers crossed, you've got another 20, 25, 30 years possibly. I guess that's another reason for being very careful about transferring away, because that's a long time for income to sustain you. Anything to add to that?
No, I would agree, really. It is, can be difficult to try and sort of play out scenarios for, you know, a long time into the future. But I guess it's trying to sort of consider and factor in as much as you can.
We've had another question about multiple DB schemes. The questioner says, if they go to assume full DB advice is necessary, but this can result in much higher charges. If it's clear the client will benefit from the secure income from one DB, is it acceptable to recommend a retain on one DB at a bridged advice if this can be explained, for example, to keep the larger income if that's a priority? Do you want to try and take that one?
I mean, I think if it's a case of looking at one scheme and sort of pointing out all the sort of benefits associated with that scheme and sort of retaining it, and it can meet all the definitions and the requirements of a bridged advice, then that should be okay. How you factor in not looking at the other DB schemes, and whether or not advice will be provided on those, I guess it's going to be sort of client specific, really, isn't it?
Okay, and there was another question. Is transferring a DB pension to a government pension advisable? Do we think that means another DB scheme?
I don't know if this is sort of talking about going to the workplace scheme consideration, but I guess the first thing to consider is whether or not government scheme will allow a transfer in. That's sort of first and foremost.
Yep.
Why is a transfer sort of taking place in the first place? You know, if it's to provide sort of flexibility or whatever, then, you know, you're not going to get that flexibility going into a government scheme, I wouldn't have thought. So I guess it's sort of weighing up the reasons for transfer, and then once establishing whether or not the transfer is the right thing to do, then considering the destination of that transfer. And if you're moving it from a defined benefit scheme into another defined benefit scheme, you'd sort of have to question why you're considering that transfer.
Indeed, agreed. Okay, thank you, Rebecca. I'm very conscious of time. Our contact details are on the screen. We will send a follow-up email with a recording of this event, and we will try to address that first question, the technical query about the TVC and the assumptions. Thank you for that. This brings us basically to the end of this series. Thank you so much to everyone for joining us today and in the previous 2 weeks. We do hope you found the sessions useful. We are planning to do an in-person workshop on this subject at our offices in Finsbury Square in London as soon as we can, hopefully at some point this year. That's starting to look more feasible, certainly than it was a year or so ago. Just a couple of things to signpost as well. We are at Grant Thornton launching our 2022 regulatory handbook later today, I think. So if you've registered for this, you should receive an email with a link to that. We're also showing, I think, a list of our forthcoming other events. And there's, some people who are interested in this, in particular, you might be interested in our sessions on ESG and indeed this new consumer duty. And indeed about preparing for the new AR regime. So yeah, that's a lot going on in the world of regulation, as there always tends to be. Rebecca, thank you so much, not just for today, but for the past 2 weeks as well.
Thank you.
Hope everyone's enjoyed it. And that brings us to the end of today's session and indeed the series. Stay well, and we look forward to seeing you again very soon. Thank you and bye-bye.